Good afternoon, colleagues. We are here for the very last session of our seminar, and I'm going to read up on our next speaker's bio, which is Dr. Rolene Brink, who's the Director of Cooperative Education here at TUT, and she will be discussing the role of work-integrated learning in education. So her bio reads as follows. Dr. Rolene Brink is currently the Director of Corporate Education at TUT. She has been involved in work-integrated learning for over 15 years and is obtained her PhD in information management with the title An Information Management Framework for the Work-Integrated Learning Process. Dr. Brink is currently involved with research on WIL that is being conducted in Ireland and South Africa. She's the lead researcher for WIL in South Africa under the auspice THENSA on an environmental scan research of work-integrated learning landscape in South Africa. Dr. Rolene Brink is the Universities of South Africa, USAF, chair for the Learning in Practice Community of Practice, working group looking at the best practices for WIL in South Africa. She's also a member of USAF World of Work Strategy Group and an executive council member of the World Association for Cooperative Education, WACE. Without further ado, Dr. Brink, are you ready for us?
Yes, I am. I just need to share my screen quickly. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, I just need to see if I can quickly share my screen. Is it visible enough?
It's opening up. Yes, it's visible enough now. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you for the opportunity. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Rolene Brink. I'm not going to introduce myself again because you already heard my short bio. My passion is the employability of the youth and the work-integrated learning within higher education institutions. I am the chair for work-integrated learning in South Africa, and I'm working with all 26 public university, TVET colleges, private universities, as well as nationally in South Africa and Africa. So my question that I want to ask today for you as audience is, do you really think that we as universities are doing our students justice and preparing them for the world of work? That's the first question. And then the second one that I want you to keep in mind is, are we preparing bamboos for students, or are we preparing an oak tree? And so I'm going to just give you a short introduction, and then we're going to look at the unemployment rate in South Africa and the agility of our students. How agile is our students? And you know, marketing is a fast-growing, fast-paced type of environment, and changes rapidly every single day. And then I will just conclude my presentation. So my question is, here is the oak tree and the bamboos is on the side. Which type of student are we preparing as higher education institutions? Not just only in South Africa, but across globally. Are we preparing students that can adapt to a situation quickly? Or are we preparing a student that is book ready for the industry? So for me, as a specialist in work-integrated learning, it's very important that we need to remember that we need to develop skills, and that we also need to change the mindsets, but not just only the mindsets of the students. We need to change the mindsets of the academia, because it's no longer a partnership just between you and the student. Okay, so if if I refer to Ginny Rometief, she's the chairperson, president and CEO of IBM, she said you have to value skills and not just the degree. So what is a degree? A degree is a piece of paper, and I see it as a driver's license for the industry. It's like you provide this your child with a license, a driver's license. Will you really buy your child a Mercedes-Benz after just receiving his driver's license? No, because your child still need to learn how to drive properly. So we need to align the skills, and we need to address by higher education institutions and the demands thereof in South Africa. So if we look at this slide, you will see on the left-hand side, you have all the knowledge and all the ideas in a circle, and you have the different hands. Now, those different hands are the stakeholders that are involved in work-integrated learning. And work-integrated learning is also a lifelong learning. We never stop learning as adults. So it's a lifelong learning curve, and we can't work in silos. My hashtag in my office is in TUT is that we need to break the silos in our organization that is TUT, break the silos between us and the students, break the silos between institutions. Okay, now I'm back. Can you still see my screen? I'm sorry, it's the internet is not good. Can you still hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yes. Can you still see this? Can you still see the screen?
Yes, we can see the screen.
Okay, so the most important part is for work integrated learning, and I think that's where the institutions need to come in. Is that we need to work together as institutions. We can't work in silos. TUT needs to work with all 26 universities, all 20 other 25 universities, needs to work together with the TVET colleges, with your private institutions, because we need to learn from one another. So it's work integrated learning is also the academia bridging the gap with the industry. And if we don't take the hand of the industry and get the industry back in our classrooms, work integrated learning is not going to happen. So I just want to, my slide is not working at this moment. Let me just see. Why is it not carrying on? Technology is not on my side today. So the tripartite curriculum strategy bridges the work-integrated academia gap. So I'm also a very strong believer that work-integrated learning is not only just for students, but that our academia also needs to do work-integrated learning. Yesterday at a meeting, one of the academics actually said that he would like to see that work integrated, that academia is also doing work integrated learning. We need to send our academia into the marketing space, and so that they can work firsthand and see what are the models and structures working in marketing to keep our curriculum relevant as well. So I read in the Business Tech in 2023, Luke Fraser said, even with a degree, South Africans can't find a job. Now, if we look at the unemployment rate and we compare it with 2023, third quarter, and 2024, we will see, and I'm only going to focus on graduate unemployment. And graduate unemployment for me is other tertiary qualifications together with graduates, because that include the entire higher education in institution sector, like your TV colleges and your technicons and privates and so forth. And in 2023, it was 29.5. Currently, we're on 30.2%. So there was an increase of 7%. So if a graduate can sit at home without a job, I'm asking the question again, are we doing our students justice? Are we preparing the student for the world of work? My belief is that we as institutions, if we take hands and we work together and work across universities, we can do much more for the students. That will also add to the employment of South Africa. So there's my question. Are higher education institutions prepare agile future fit students for the world of work? So are we creating bamboos? Because if you bend the bamboo, then it adapts to the situation and it can go back to its original form. So if we look at the World Economic Forum top 10 skills, it's analytical thinking, and it's divided into four clusters. The one cluster is problem solving, self-management, working with people, technology and use and development. So if we look at the problem solving is in class, if you have a guest lecturer, and I was professor at UJ and I've worked with as an academic. Now, if you invite a guest lecturer, are you telling the guest lecturer what to cover, or are you asking the guest lecturer to bring a societal problem to the class and see how they can debate that problem and solve that problem? Or let's say a marketing societal problem that you have within the environment, bring it to the class, split your class into small groups and give them a problem and say, solve it. And then the students need to present to the industry in different groups, and the industry will say, yes, that will work in the industry or not. Are you bringing that to class, or are you just having a lecturer standing there and just another lecture with 20, 50 different slides and presenting that to the class? So we need to start bring critical thinking and analysis to class, creativity, reasoning. That is problem solving. So give the student a problem and see how they solve the problem. Then you have self-management. That is your active learning and your resilience and stress and tolerance. How are you preparing that student for that environment? So working with people, it's very important that the students, that you teach your students in the class environment how to work in a group, how to work as a team, but not only just with the class teams. What I've done 1 year in my class is I worked across faculties. I've worked with faculty of humanities, with communication and the law and the IT students. And I've combined that where the students learn from one another from the different domains. Your IT students develop a website, but your legal students will inform the IT students what is legally correct to be on the website. And your PR students that is doing an article on a specific event needs to also work closely with the IT to get it on the system, but then work also closely with the legal students to advise them on what is legally correct to ask the person, according to the PUPIA Act, what can go on the website. So are we building that different working together, not only with the specific domain as marketing, but also across fields. And then technology use and development. I also believe that none of the qualifications can be presented without technology. Technology is here to stay, and technology is part of all the qualifications. So it's very important that we bring in technology specifically in marketing, with the digital marketing side of things. So here is how I see an agile future fit student. You will see I have on the left-hand side, I have a globe. So that's the innovative part. We need to be innovative in our classrooms and bring innovative ideas. So it's before COVID, yes, we go to the class, we present. Now we need to throw the box away and just think innovatively how we can adapt and also bring the innovative ideas into the classroom. But with the innovation also going very strong is your stakeholder engagement, your collaboration, and collaboration with other institutions, collaboration with your CTAS, collaboration with your students, with other faculties, with industries. We need to take hands and we need to make a small difference. Only then you can use the different modalities of work-integrated learning. And work-integrated learning is the umbrella terminology in South Africa, according to the USAF guidelines that was approved by the Minister Blyton Simandi during COVID in 2020. And those modalities are problem-based learning. And I already gave you an example of a problem-based learning where you bring the industry with a societal problem and do it as a small hackathon within the classroom where the students then will present their solutions and ideas. Project-based learning is typically where marketing can work together with a company like Coca-Cola or with a company like Colgate, and they come up with a societal problem that they have and they work directly with the company. That will give you the 10 top skills of the Economic World Forum. Simulations is where you can use a virtual reality or augmented reality. Then we have internship, where the students then will also work within the marketing space. Community engagement, where you can do your students in the community, but it's not painting a church or painting a school. It must be marketing related events where you can use the students for community engagement. And the new kid on the block is definitely entrepreneurship. And with marketing, I think that we can strengthen the unemployment rate to being self-employed. But also then we need to look at the ecosystem of entrepreneurship, because you can't just have a module on entrepreneurship and do a 6 months module for entrepreneurship and show them how to do a business canvas and say, there you go, now you can start your own business. That's not entrepreneurship. You need to mentor and coach the student from first year, changing the mindset to an entrepreneur mindset. And then at the end of the third year, they will have a sustainable marketing, a digital marketing company that can support the community or their own business. So Agile Future Fit Student, how do I see that? I already, the previous slide show you the different modalities with problem-based learning. That is how we deepen the learning of a student. And we need to start with these modalities in their first year. You can't only do work-integrated learning in the third year for 6 months and say you prepare the students for the world of work. Biggest nonsense, biggest rubbish. And I will tell it to anyone. You only do work integrated learning properly if you start with a modality in the first year of community engagement or problem-based learning in a classroom. You connect the student already with the industry. That's where you enriches the relationship, because the student immediately start knowing who are the best marketers in the country. They already start their LinkedIn profile in their first year and follow these top marketers or companies within the industry. So they start following them, they start having these relationships. You invite them to their classes, you deepen the learning, you broaden the future of the student. You broaden their mindset, you broaden the scope. And that's when we empower our students for the world of work. And I'm going to close with this. The Japanese proverb said, a bamboo that bends is stronger than an oak that resists. So are we preparing agile future fit students, or are we preparing an oak tree that resists to agility in the marketing place? And from my side, my hashtags are that we are stronger together and that silos needs to fall. Thank you so much for the opportunity, Ilisma and team. I will stop here for questions and answers. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Brink, for that very informative presentation. I am going to open up the floor for any questions, also online, or any comments. Hey, Dr. Drotsky. Okay, Mr. Yuster, there's a microphone next to you.
Dr. Brink, thank you very much. Please excuse me for not mentioning you in the beginning of my talk as an invitee to join you in this on this platform. So thank you very much for the invitation.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much. I also work with a company that is working within the informal sector or the developing sector, and for common interest township market, that is promoting the Tiger brands. So yes, if there's an opportunity that some of your students would like to become entrepreneurs, our model is very, well, their model, mine theirs, is to give them opportunity to work with in the Tiger brands framework with the products. And at the end of their period or time, they then get PDY Limited companies set up for them, and that they can become a business, an entrepreneurial business with access to world-class products. And also by then they've developed their market. So that's something we can chat about. And if students would like to engage in that space, you can get hold of me and I'll pass you on to that team.
Thank you so much. I will really appreciate that if you can just share your information with me. Then I will definitely set up a meeting with you. What I've also done at TUT is I've started an advisory council. And as soon as I see the success of it, then I will definitely introduce it to my other colleagues at other institutions as well, because it is a big need for us to have industry at the institutions. We can't have an institution without the industries. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Are there any other questions?
Yeah, just a comment. What we did in marketing this year, we worked alongside the entrepreneurship department. We then open it to the students to say, okay, because we're not industry placed yet. We said to them, okay, do you want to either go the simulation route or do you want to go the entrepreneurship route? So we have an actual company that I work on, but there was the other option of entrepreneurship as well. I'm not sure, Suzanne, how many of the students roundabout from Bombela went for the entrepreneurship route? I know there was a few that Around about five, from Bombela campus alone. So I'm not sure in Pretoria campus how many. But at the end of the day, they get a mentor, exactly what Dr. Brink said. They get a mentor from the entrepreneurship, not the entrepreneurship department. It's external company mentors that then guides the student through the whole process of the plan. But they have to have an idea. So they first have to pitch this idea to the entrepreneurship department, the stakeholders. And then they say, okay, it is good enough. So you qualify. Thelma, do you know how many of the Pretoria campus? So it's not many. So it's really like Dr. Brink said as well, it's not open that all can be entrepreneurs. Okay. I think somebody also mentioned that it's go for the entrepreneurship, but it's not to say you can set them up for failure if you go that total route of that as well, because not it must be in you as well to start a business. So we'll have that type of collaboration as well this year. However, next year we go to industry place, but I still think there is a way that one can bring in the entrepreneurship thing, maybe on a lower level type of thing, to see already in second year if there's potential for
There's definitely Dr. Vandenberg option for that, because I know the mentor council, the coaches council in South Africa, they need to do certain hours a week community engagement. So we can always get business councils for you that will assist the universities for free on a 2-hour basis if you identify students in your first year that have that entrepreneurial ability. Then we can get the coaches in that can coach them from first, second, and third year. So in third year already, for the work integrated learning, they already have a sort of a sustainable business, and then we'll just finalize that year. That's another way to go for work integrated learning and entrepreneurship. But we can have a conversation around that, but I'm going to share that on the Learning in Practice community of practice with the rest of the institutions as well.
Okay, I see there are two comments in the chat box. One is from Salum, who's saying that the SAIMS organization have opportunities that will open up for Will in academia. And then the second one is from Prof. Makita, where she's just alluding to the fact that she likes what Dr. Brink said. We should not work in silos, but with others across universities, industry, and international, including students. Yes.
Thank you so much.
Are there any other questions or closing comments? Okay, let me see one.
This is just a comment, not really a question. I think coming from hospitality management discipline, the seminar as a whole has been highly insightful. I think there are areas for interdisciplinary collaboration, especially looking at the marketing curriculum development discussions on a more entrepreneurial and strategic focus, considering how the hospitality industry is still recovering from environmental uncertainty, such as the COVID-19 pandemic. Looking even further at more rural communities in South Africa, such interdisciplinary collaborations may encourage AI integration and more of the analytical skills in the hospitality industry at the relevant managerial levels to foster those local development initiatives in the communities. Even more to chew on, looking at the interdisciplinary collaboration at the work integrated learning level. Structuring and monitoring issues that students in hospitality do face when getting to the industry for work integrated learning. So it has really been very insightful for me on my part, and I will be discussing as much of this in the hospitality environment as I can. So thank you so much.
I think the whole purpose of this like Prof. Makita said, and Dr. Brank, we mustn't work in silos. And I think that's why, if we weren't introduced you to Grant, for instance, we wouldn't have shared with you what we did, or what Dr. Brank, for instance, with her opportunity that she's opening up to anybody. So I think at the end of the day, that's what this is about. Like when we started this whole conversation yesterday, we are not in competition with each other. We have our own markets. We have our own students, all of that type of thing. So it's really to enhance and be student-centered and move away from, okay, this is our little environment and this is what we do. If there's best practices, if there's ideas how to incorporate this type of things, we need to share it amongst each other. And I think, again, yes, there wasn't a lot of time for interaction during these 2 days because programs were very full. But I will definitely, if you're okay, we will have a little poll if you want to share the information of each other, that we reach out and say, these are the people that offers marketing too, from other universities. If you want to get involved with them, here are their details, that type of things. So that we can, network.
Yeah, so from my side, a closing remark will be, it's basically an invite to everyone. If you need any assistance or want to spin off your ideas on work integrated learning and how to be more innovative within your classroom and look at different ways, please feel free to contact me at any given time. That is my passion, because at the end of the day, it's not about a UJ or a TUT or DUT. For me, it's about the country and our country and the youth, because we need to prepare them better to take over and to make our economy stronger. So it's not about an institution at all. I'm not here to compare to anyone, but I'm here to assist and to help anyone so that we can get the standard and what we deliver to industry on the best level that we can. It's for me, the most important thing is to say, here's a student, the student is adaptable and can adapt to any situation and can walk into a company and run with it. Thank you, Dr. Van Ammer.
Thank you very much, Dr. Brink, for that very insightful and informative presentation. Now, the floor is open for our last segment, which is an open discussion on the way forward. And I'd like to ask Dr. Vandenberg to facilitate that for us. Any discussions, whether on the floor or online, then we can just conversate and then take it forward.
I think at the end of the day, we've learned a lot over the past 2 days. I think what I realized is we have very similar modules, okay? Even the international universities, if I look at what they offer, it's very similar to what we do. However, I feel still when I think, who was it? UCT, or who's got that consumer insight name? I like that more than consumer behavior, because it feels so outdated. Some of the module names, even I know the content, but who said it again this morning? Paul Harrigan, I think, said that people or whoever look at the name of the module, they look at the name of the qualification, and that motivates them actually to take that module or to go for that qualification. So, yes. So it's how we market our qualifications at the end of the day, how we promote it, because we introduced electives in our advanced and postgrads that nobody was interested in professional selling and brand communication. So at the end of the day, it's maybe not the right names, or it's not digital marketing is everything now, while they might get actual jobs in sales. They're not interested because they're not sold on what we offer in that module. So at the end of the day, I think we've learned a lot, and at least we got together to meet each other. I think that was the main purpose, even though we are less people now than yesterday. It is everybody's busy, and two days out of the office is hectic. But I think it's just to see each other, to meet each other. That is the main thing. And to start with collaborations and networking after this, and see how we can help and assist each other moving forward. So is there anybody else that want to add something from this? Dr. Drotsky?
Yeah, it's not really to add something, and sorry, I'll still get you a present. I'm a man, I don't think of stuff like that until I have to do it. Sorry. I would just like to, I know everybody and those still online, I'd like to thank you, Ulisma. I think you did the majority of the arrangements. And we are really thankful for everything you've done. And Brock, mercy again for starting AMAC years back. I remember we were one of the first people actually at AMAC, sitting in a room like this, actually just talking. That's how it started originally. And hopefully from there on, it will just grow. And thank you very, very much for everything and for the arrangements. And I think everybody enjoyed it. And like you said, I think it's the context that we built with each other and even with people from outside that can assist us. So thank you very much for that. And thank you, everybody. I hope you all have a safe trip back to your respective homes and places. I know some of you still got a distance to travel, Cape Town and so forth, in a Free State and PE, or I'm not even going to time pronounce it. And Mafeking of Mafeking, as it's called now. So thank you very much, everybody. I hope you've got safe travels. See you next year.
Why do you miss her? She's here. Yeah, Lebu, thank you. You were a good timekeeper. You were a very good MC, and we appreciate that, all the effort that you also put into this. So thank you for that as well. Is Prof. Makita still in there?
Yes.
Okay, Prof. Makita.
I just want to interrupt because Dr. Droski said we'll meet again next year, and if we can just ask colleagues who want to volunteer to host this next year, we'll be happy.
Prof. Makita, I heard something, but I'm not sure. I didn't hear it clearly. There was somebody that said UCT and CPUT want to collaborate and work together. So I will engage. I did speak to the, I think it's the Associate Dean of Research that was here. I will speak to him and just follow up, Prof. But I want to from my side as well say thank you for you to take the initiative years back. I know Anton said thank you now already, but really you did. If it wasn't for you that started this AMAC, I think it was what, 14 years ago?
No, that was 2016.
Oh, okay. 2016, but okay. Almost. So 8 years, yes. But at the end of the day, your passion for marketing and your dedication for all of these years, really, it's admirable. And we missed you here today. And we know you're not healthy and not feeling well today and everything. But please just look after yourself. You're valuable to us, and that you're ready for next year. And that me and you can have a lekker cup of coffee.